Welcome to another episode of Smash Writing. I am your host today, yo man, Paul. And today we are reviewing the movie that's on Paramount Plus, and it was streaming since the June 23rd. And of course, if you read the title, you already know what I'm talking about. I am talking about Beavis and Butthead Do the Universe, which is a sequel to the first film, Do America. Okay, that was 1996. I gotta admit, I am a real fan of the series, even when they revived it back in 2011. I love Do America. To this day, I can watch it over and over again. It's a fun ride. It gives you a little bit of everything. And it's Beavis and Butthead. Like, Beavis and Butthead was an icon of the 90s. I don't care what, like, there might be 100 icons in the 90s. I'm just using it as an example. Beavis and Butthead has to be in one of those 100s. Like, they came out in the 90s, and it was a great show by Mike Judge, which we know he created a bunch of other shows and so forth. Now, let's talk about Do the Universe. Okay. I did not know anything about this until probably 2 weeks before it was released. And the trailers came out, and I'm like, oh man, obviously with vacations and personal life, and right now the summer is kicking our asses with movies and everything else like that. I'm like, all right, this is definitely on my watch list, so I will get to it because of so many reasons. So I finally did. I'm actually recording this episode, and I actually watched the film exactly last night. So there isn't a small couple of days from when I watched it. I literally just watched it last night. So, where do I go with this film? Well, let's talk about the plot. The film starts in 1998, where we see a Beavis and Butthead at a science fair. Of course, there are shenanigans of kicking each other in the balls, basically, to see who can outlast who. Somehow, Butthead finds a field goal kicking foot, which kicks Beavis across the damn gymnasium and starts a fire and everything else like that. So they go to court, and in court they are told to, their punishment is to go to summer camp, which is would be a space camp. Okay, there at space camp they see a shuttle port deporting device. And it looks like to them a penis going into a vagina. And instantly they spend all day in the control room. I think that number was right around 18 hours. They spend 18 hours just jamming the docking device because they still continue to think that it is a penis going into a vagina. Okay. They do catch the attention of one of the captains of Serena Ryan, and she wants them to train with them because they show knowledge of what she appears. They showed knowledge of docking this machine onto the International Space Station, which gives them great skills. So she makes them part of the crew. And there they get set to go up in space. Beavis gets interviewed, and once again, we know how Beavis and Butthead's minds work. Everything is related to sex. So Beavis gives this speech about, this is his dream and everything else like that. In reality, he's talking about having sex with Serena, and they're asking him about being a teenager going up into space. Just to kind of show you how stupid, once again, they are. So, they go up in space, and instantly they bring their shenanigans up in space to the point where they point a telescope at the sun, and it basically blinds them for a little bit. And here, they are once again given their mission to go ahead and dock on the International Space Station. While, needless to say, they completely botched it because they're blind. And I don't know how these smart astronauts do not basically realize that they're blind. Nevertheless, they go and they cause a whole destruction, and they're thrown into space. We reveal that the shuttle only has enough of oxygen to get a crew of 5 back to Earth, and there's 7 of them. So Serena first sacrificed herself once again. Beavis and Butthead take this as a sign of sex. So they get their spacesuits on, and Serena realizes that they're just horny teens. And while they're out in space, she basically uses the docking device and swats them like a complete fly. Wham! And they just go off into space, which they ended up drifting into space and getting sucked in by a black hole. Now, they get sucked through a black hole, and they come back and they fall to Earth in Galveston, Texas. But it's not 1998 anymore. It is 2022. And they see that life has changed. Serena is no longer an astronaut. She is actually the governor, the Texas governor. And of course, that's the first sign they see. So once again, to them, this has been mere minutes. It hasn't been 24 years. So they think it's a sign that she still wants to have sex with them. And they go on their shenanigan ways of trying to get her so they can have sex again. Here we meet another version of Beavis and Butthead, and they introduce that there is a multiverse. These Beavis and Buttheads are called Smart Beavis and Smart Butthead. Very creative. But they're still goofy as all the other universes of Beavis and Butthead, which we learn that there are thousands of them. Nevertheless, their arrival sets off a space warp, basically, tracker. And now you got the government after them because they came through a black hole. So obviously they want to get Beavis and Butthead. But understand that 1998 and 2022, when those only 24 years apart, seems like a generation and a whole different world. Beavis and Butthead is introduced to a cell phone, an iPhone, where they take a picture of family, but they keep the phone, and they learn how to, that, you know, we all have our credit cards hooked up to there, and they go on a shopping spree of buying nachos and cheese. Yes, nachos and cheese. So, there they go, and Beavis starts to talk to Siri, thinking it's Serena. So he's kind of being misled by an AI, and it sets up these whole bunch of motions to where they go back to their house. And they realize that their house was actually sold, and old people live there now. You think it doesn't get crazier? It gets crazier. So Serena learns that they are alive, and she thinks that they are going to come clean and preach that she tried to kill them and they were lost in space for 24 years. Here they come across a university. They learn about white privilege, and they steal a cop car thinking because they're white, they can steal it, and they end up going to jail. There, Beavis takes a lot of drugs, and he becomes the infamous Cornholio, which he says his famous lines, "I need pee-pee for my bunghole," in jail. Now, this is actually where, in my head, I'm thinking this movie can go way off the freaking limbs and give Cornholio pee-pee for his bunghole. But they don't. Instead, the prisoners can't understand his speech, and they think he's wanting this, wanting that, TV, toilet paper, TP, all it gets way absurd of what they think he's saying. But he incites a riot. Now, the team, the SWAT teams and all that come in, but the warden, who realizes who they are and what they look like, realize that they died in 98, and somehow they're back as if they look like they were still in 98, so they must be angels, so he lets them go. Finally, Serena and her team catches up to Beavis and Butthead after all this, and they were going to kill him, but her lieutenant governor sets him free, and she has to chase him down again. Here she realizes that they're not here to turn her in. They're just dumb teenagers. Like, didn't you establish this in 98 that they were completely dumb? And yet, you think they kind of grew, even though they looked the same in 2022 as in 1998. You didn't think they were going to still be immature. Anyway, she basically, you know, lets him go. And that's when smart Beavis and smart Butthead comes and saves the day. And knowing that Serena is an astronaut at heart, Beavis takes her into a portal. And then it's Beavis, smart Beavis gets rewarded that he was the first Beavis across the multiverse of Beavises to get laid. If this is actually true or not, who knows? Because he's given an award by a female Beavis, an older female Beavis, and an older version Butthead. So, kind of tell you that he probably didn't get laid. I think in across any universe, Beavis and Butthead are just horny teenagers that are never going to get laid. That's fact right there. Anyway, as a reward from the government and their apologies, they get their house back, and the house is set up the way it was in 1998. And the movie ends there. I've seen critics, there was 18 critics, 18 reviews, I should say, and they're giving this a positive review. I'm assuring you, I don't think it was horrible, but nothing was funny about this movie. The music that once made Beavis and Butthead a good wasn't there. I remember from Do America, they had that epic scene in the desert with Beavis and that rock song, and it was awesome. They had really none of that. Part of the magic of Beavis and Butthead was the music, and they just kind of forgotten about that. Was there some music involved? Yes, but very little of it, and nothing exciting to really go home about. Some of you said it was a good follow-up to Do America. I disagree. Do America was its peak movie at this point, and Do the Universe kind of felt like a true nature of just a couple of bad episodes in a season. You know, like any good season, you'll have a lot of good episodes, but you'll just have a string of bad episodes that were just kind of like filler. This is filler. Now, this is a way to bring them back in the sense of into the public's eyes. Okay, but right now you're doing it in a negative way, because the last time we seen them was in 2011 when they revived the show for like 20 episodes, and I guess it fell through. You know, the 90s was where they were at. If they're gonna keep trying to bring them back, then I would say, you know, fine, you reintroduce them, but bring your A game next time. This one definitely did not have their A game. Yes, the shenanigans was the same, but on a lower level. if you're going to give this title to the universe, you better do the universe Beavis and Butthead style, not this watered-down version of Beavis and Butthead. And that's what I think we actually got in this film, was a watered-down Beavis and Butthead. In the end, I am giving this, once again, I'm giving this a C, maybe 70% at best. It wasn't completely garbage, but it wasn't good. It wasn't okay. It was there. It was average. And because of that, that's why I'm giving it a C, 70%. If you are a Beavis and Butthead fan, check it out. See what you think. I mean, this is my review of it. The plot, like I said, the laughter really wasn't there. The music really wasn't there. The cheesy dope jokes were toned down. And I get it. That's maybe the culture today. And I completely understand that. And that's why, like, if you can't bring back, you know, for whatever studio purposes or public image things, if you can't bring back what made them famous and, you know, you're going to give me a watered-down version, don't bring it back. Do something else, Mike Judge. You're better than that. But, see, 70%. Until next time, bye-bye.